One of them was a guy named Rob Solomon, who was the secretary of the club.
Right.
One of them was a fellow named Bruce Schweiger, who was the special projects manager. And one of them was a guy named Mike Rockblatt, who was the treasurer. And they made a, and they said, they figured they'd go bring me along with the president. So they picked this following Tuesday to go down to Irvine. None of us drove, so we, and these other three guys were all in high school half day. So the plan was that I would meet them outside Hamilton High School. Mike Rockblatt's mother would pick us up and drive us to Irvine. I take the news, the bus down to the Pico Robertson news store. I bought my comics. I bought the new Marvels for the month. I open them up, and there's an ad for Marvel Mania International, this fan club that's now this new merchandising thing. It's selling posters and decals, and they're taking your money from them and occasionally delivering one. They didn't fill half the orders. And there's the post office box is in Culver City, California. I was a few miles from Culver City. I was 5 miles from Culver City. I went, my God, Marvel's opened an office out here? I went to a payphone. I asked for Marvel International. They connected me with this place. This man answered, and he said, oh, yeah, you're a local comic book fan. Well, come on down to the office. We want to meet the local comic book fans. We're setting up, we're starting this new big fan club and stuff. And I said, well, I have to go to Irvine right now to meet Jack Kirby. And he says, and I thought, first I thought he'd go, who's that? But then he'd go, oh, yeah, give Jack my best, and you come in tomorrow. I said, well, where are your offices? He gave me the address. He was 3 blocks from where I was, that phone booth. So we drove, a bunch of us drive down to meet Jack. We get to this place in Irvine. Mike's mother drops us off, drives off. She's going to come back for us in a couple hours. And we knock on the door, and there's no answer. And we go, we got the wrong house, and whatever, and there's no answer. We peeked in the window, and there's a bunch of Marvel comics on the pile. Okay, we got the right house. 5 minutes later, Roz drives up. Jack gets out of the car, holding an unlit cigar, and we say hello to him. And we introduce ourselves very nervously. And I introduce myself first. I'm Mark Evanier. Oh, nice to meet you. And I introduced him to, and this is Robert Solomon. And Jack turns to Rob and says, it's your fault. You hired him. And Rob goes, what? This is the first time in my life of many that I didn't know what the hell Jack was talking about. And he says, you hired him. Well, Rob was in high school. He never had a job. He never hired anybody. You hired him. It's your fault. You started it all. It's your fault. And Jack is, you can tell Jack thinks he's saying something brilliant and funny and clever. He's laughing at his own joke. And we don't get it. And finally, I went, wait a minute. We had looked, you know, being comic fans, we all read the comics. And in the statement of ownerships of old Marvel, certain old Marvel books, it said, Robert Solomon, controller, who there was a guy named Robert Solomon on the staff at Marvel. And I turned, and we occasionally joked our Rob Solomon was the same Rob Solomon, said, oh, are you really working for Marvel? Were you really working for Marvel in your prenatal work? And I said, Robert Solomon hired Stan Lee. And Jack said, yes! And Jack turns to me and he says, you know your comics, young man. And then, and that was the joke, you know. And so then, as we talked to Jack for a while, every so often, he would say something like, so then Martin Goodman did this, and my friends would look blank. And I go, well, Martin Goodman's the publisher of Marvel. And Jack turned to me and said, yeah, you know your comics. You know, and he was all impressed with that. While we're sitting there, the phone rings, and it's Stan Lee. They got a plot of Fantastic Four. So Jack says, excuse me, and he takes the phone right in front of us, and we saw the entirety of a Fantastic Four plotted in about 90 seconds. It consisted of Jack saying, yeah, I'm going to do this story about so-and-so and so-and-so. Okay, I'll try to make it interesting. Thank you. Yeah, it was something like that. I don't remember it exactly, but I went, that's how comics plotted? Well, with Lee and Kirby, it was. Jack had on his drawing table that day the pencil art, 2/3 completed, for an issue of Fantastic Four. It was, I think it was 97, the one with the monster from the Lost Lagoon. And we looked at these pencils and we went, we could not, and he had a lot of other pencil pages around, we could not believe how good the pencil art was. We've never seen Jack Kirby pencil art, ever. And as you know, it's kind of jarring. You've all seen this stuff. You kind of go, gee, even with the best inkers, lots of stuff never made it into print. Yeah. Mike did as great a job as anybody could, but there's something in Jack's raw, pure pencils.
Oh, yeah, it's no matter how good you might be, you can finish a statement, but you really can't plus him. I mean, nobody asked, but my two favorite Jack Kirby inkers are Joe Sinnott and me. Now, that sounds immodest, but and the basic difference between us is that Joe Sinnott inked Jack MGM. I inked Jack Warner Brothers. Continue.
Oh, yeah, okay, that's a good accomplishment. Yes, and Vince Coletta was like Roger Corman.
Somebody yesterday at Barry Geller's Lord of Light, he was showing all the phony stuff that was originally Lord of Light that was remade and Argo logos put on it, and the stuff that was supposed to be in the film that actually showed Jack's work, and for some reason it never appears in Argo. And I said, well, because if they did use it, Stan would want to make a cameo in the film.
Yes, you have a question?
Yeah, while you're on the subject, before we leave the subject of Marvel Mania, I'd like to say that I have an indirect connection. My brother-in-law, Jerry Nolan, used to print all of the Marvel Mania stuff in Culver City there.
Wow. That sounds familiar. Jerry Nolan sounds
on familiar. La Cienega Boulevard, he had a place, the Quickprint Brothers, yeah. Called them across the street. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a little print shop that did a lot of the Marvel Mania stuff over there. Yes.
And we're very sorry you never got paid.
Yeah.
By the way, Mark and I plan to resurrect Marvel Mania International. We're going to have color catalogs, posters, and of course we're not going to deliver any of it.
Yes. Well, do you remember the series of super villains that Jim Steranko penciled for Marvel Mania?
Yes.
He came and stayed at our house for a week. So Steranko's in my house for a week, and we literally changed our entire life. We got up at 1 in the afternoon and went to bed at 3 or 4 in the morning. But he penciled those pieces at my house and then asked me to ink them. And then he said, when I get the originals back, since you put me up for a week and put up with a whole lifestyle change, you can have the originals.
Wow.
And then a couple of years later, when I sold a couple of them to raise some money to begin my 16mm collecting days, he said, how come you sold that stuff?
The premise we're going to use for this, where we take orders for things and then don't fill them, is what is now called crowdfunding. Anyway, so Jack had this, on the drawing table, he had this fantastic full issue. And I, at that point in my life, was a little bit of an artist. I was making a few bucks doing some drawings for magazines and such. It was something I never really pursued, but if people were going to pay me for it, I would do it. And my friend said, oh, Mark here has drawn fanzine covers. He's an artist. And Jack said, yeah, here, why don't you finish a panel for me, kid? And I thought, wait a minute, he wanted me to sit at his drawing table, just as he had Mike sit there and ink that one first piece, and he wanted me to finish a panel, pencil a panel. And I thought, you know, I'm not good enough to finish the art of the worst guy at Marvel, let alone the best. And he said, no, do it, just draw a hand on that figure, things like that. And I went, and I tried to beg off, and I thought, oh, well, I would ruin an entire page, you know, like that. And then I thought, like, wait a minute, Jack's got an eraser. and Joe Sinnott's inking the book, so how bad could it be? So I drew the hand in, and I assume after I left, Jackie raised it and did it right. But when that issue came out, it was not inked by Joe Sinnott, it was inked by Frank Giacoya. And I thought to myself, Sinnott refused to ink it when I saw that. I said to Jack, at one point, I gave Jack some of the fancy I'd written. And I'd just leave them and he might look at them later. He sat down and started reading one of them. He said, okay, I'll read this. Roz, take him on a tour of the house. And he sat and he read a story that I'd written in one of these fanzines. And he said to me, hey, you've got some ability. And he had told me about the guy at Marvel Mania didn't know anything about comics. He said, that guy needs someone like you to tell him. He doesn't know. He keeps thinking that we do Billy Batson, Captain Marvel. He didn't know what he had. So the next day I went to Marvel Mania, and he hired me, because Jack had called him and said, get this kid, he knows comics real well. And then I, in turn, got them to hire Steve and a lot of other guys who worked there, until we realized the depths of the larceny that was going on, and we got the hell out of there.
It was fun.
Anyway, one of the many people they stiffed was Jack. Those giant posters that you've all seen that Jack did, he never got paid for those. And one day, Jack got fed up with all of the lies and stalling, and he comes down to the office, and the guy in charge was in Rome at the time. Now, why was he in Rome? Steve, tell them why he was in Rome.
Because he had gotten a brilliant idea that he was going to build a theme park called Rome BC, which would recreate ancient Rome. And what he was going to do is buy the sets from a movie that was shot in Spain of the Roman Empire. Now, what he didn't realize was, or he didn't know that these sets are made out of chicken wire and plaster. And, you know, you can't move them. They fall apart. But no, he didn't have a dime to his name, but he was going to build an amusement park in Rome, Italy.
Yeah.
And that's what he was off. So, and what he had was, he bought these little soldiers and little Roman men, and he had it on his desk, and he would, like, line them all up and had them all set up. And I remember one time I came in there, and I leaned on his desk, and they all fell over. And I'm like, oh, you ruined my Roman.
Is Marvel Mania not connected with Marvel Comics in New York?
No, not at all.
Independent?
All it was a guy who was a promoter. This can get real long away from Jack, but essentially this man, his name was Don Wallace. He had been a promoter, and he had been a salesman, and he was always trying to start a company, and he'd start a company and would go bankrupt, and he'd flee the sheriff and open another company someplace else. And at one point, he had done a thing with 3D postcards. He had done this Star Trek.
You know, the kind with the
lenticular things, and it had not gone well. But he had done a Marvel bunch of things for kids in the audience, and he got all these brochures that Marvel had saying we've got 75 million readers and we reach all these things. And he thought, well, maybe I can do something with Marvel characters. And he flew back to New York and made a big pitch to Martin Goodman and Chip Goodman. And at that moment, as I understand it, I'm putting a few things together here, Marvel had been acquired by Perfect Film and Chemical Corporation, a guy named Marty Ackerman, who was, you know, the man who drove the Saturday Evening Post into the ground, was complaining, why don't we have merchandising like DC did? And they thought he was the answer. So they gave him a license for almost no money in advance to produce Marvel material and to create a licensing division. Marvel didn't own it. They were licensing it to him to do. And he had this incredible thing which could have made him a multi-billionaire if he had exploited it properly, but he didn't know what he was doing and he had no capital. And he was just, you know, it takes money to start a business. He didn't have money. And it also takes some knowledge. He didn't have a lot of knowledge. So there was this brief period when Marvel Mania was the business of the moment. He was then going to flee and start another one, which ultimately he did. So Steve and I worked there for a while, tried to make it as honest as possible, and finally one day we gave up. One night we went in, after hours, we went through all the files, and we found out how bad off the company was financially. We found out how many other names this guy had been operating under. He'd kept, for some reason, all this incriminating evidence in his file. We also, remember the photos we found?
Yes, we did.
One of the things he had done when he was doing the 3D posters is he decided to do pictures of naked women. And we found all these photos of him with the naked woman.
Uchi Daigar.
You remember Uchi? You know Uchi Daigar with anybody? She was a German woman with huge breasts. You know, every men's magazine. So we toyed with mailing those to his wife. We got the hell out of the company, and we called Jack, and we called Stanko, and we called Stan Lee, and we called everybody we knew who we trusted, we thought was going to get screwed here, and told them, get out of business with this guy. He's going under, he's taking us all down. And we got out of the company. So,
but you know, the irony is that the material itself was great. I mean, the posters were beautiful, the magazine
was great. Because Jack did, well, the magazine, I did the magazine and it wasn't that great, but Jack did those posters and the guy had nothing to do with them. But I'll give you an example. We can get into the weeds on this stuff here. So the original deal was Jack was going to do 8 posters. He was going to put these out. And they were Silver Surfer, Fantastic Four, Doctor Doom, Thor, Hulk, Spider-Man, the Marvel superheroes in a group shot, and leaving out one. I said the Silver Surfer was Galactus. Thor, Captain America, Doctor Doom, Captain America. So Jack had done these 8 posters. If you look at the Marvel Mania, you can see the 8 posters. Even though the Marvel said you can't have 8 Jack Kirby posters, half the line has to be other artists. So Jack had contacted Steranko, and Steranko had come up with 2 posters. One of Nick Fury, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D., one of Captain America. The Nick Fury one was never printed as a poster, but they took Jack's Captain America away and put Steranko's Captain America in its place. They had Herb Trimpe trace the Hulk poster, and you see in my book, The Before and After, which I don't think there's anything in the world that made Jack angrier than that. Because here's a poster, it's his work, somebody else's name is signed to it, and he's getting $0, because he was on a strict commission basis. Trimpe got paid for it a flat rate. Trimpe got paid, Jack didn't. The Romita poster was changed a lot, but it's still somewhat Jack's design. And then, when Wallace was running around Marvel's offices one time, when he went back there, he saw this Black Knight piece of artwork, which was a presentation piece that had been penciled by Howard Purcell to be the artist on Black Knight, and it had been inked by Tom Palmer. And it was an orphan piece of art they hadn't used. And he said, and Wallace, not knowing the Black Knight was not a major Marvel character, said, oh, that'd make a great poster. And that became the 8th poster because it was free. So that's why there was a Black Knight poster. And this could give you the idea of the depths of knowledge this man had of Marvel history. So they put out these 8 posters and they didn't sell at the rates that he thought they should, because he was expecting every poster to sell 10,000, 50,000, whatever. As an example, he had this nuts, he thought kids would go nuts for decal sheets, and he designed dozens and dozens of decal sheets of Marvel heroes to sell. He thought that this was going to be his big money thing, because kids would keep buying the decal sheets and putting the decals and everything on, and they'd buy more decal sheets. So went to a company that made decal sheets. Decalcomania it was called. Mm-hmm. And he got a price quote from them for how many enrolls, runs of 50,000, how many runs of 100,000. And they said, well, in 50,000 run, the sheets will cost you 52 cents a piece. So he advertised them in the Marvel Mania catalog for $1.25 plus 25 cents postage. Mm. And if you sold 50,000 of them, you can do the math, that's a pretty nice piece of change. When the catalog came out, he had sold 900 of them. He went back to the company and said, instead of 50,000, how much they cost if I get 900 made? They said, oh, those would be $1.40 a piece. So he's selling $1.40 decal sheets for $1.25. Can you figure out what went wrong with this company? The only two things he had that were really profitable, the magazine made a lot of money for some reason because it was priced right. I was not getting paid much of anything, so it didn't cost much to produce. And the number one poster, by far, ahead of all the others, was that Silver Surfer poster that Jeff did, which was colored by Marie Severin, by the way. Everything else made $4 or lost money. And that's one of the reasons that company for
one. Why do you think the Silver Surfer sold more?
I think it was the best poster. Or people in the catalog that looked the best. I don't know. The character was popular. Maybe at that point people were horny for Jack Silver Surfer because they weren't getting it at that point. I don't know.
Well, I grew up as a Jack Kirby fan because, you know, I'm an old woodcutcher, and so I, as a kid, was in love with all of the Simon Kirby books, and at the trading post down this road, I lived in the country, you know, for a nickel, I could get these old DC Kirby things. And not being the brightest kid in the world, I identified his work when I saw it, but I never paid attention really to that it was Jack Kirby, but I knew it was this artist, the way most of us knew when somebody, when a duck was a Karl Barks duck. Now in the 60s, mid-60s, or early 60s, I started getting interested in comic books other than the Dell product. And I see these Marvel books, and I see the signature Jack Kirby, and I'm thinking, this reminds me of something, but there's something missing. And then in fanzines, the rare occasion that someone would have an opportunity to print his pencils, I looked at it and I went, it's that guy. This is the guy I grew up loving his work. And why doesn't anyone ever ink him? So, it, you know, I'm working for Russ Manning and all these other people in the mid-60s and actually worked on Marvel Superheroes and finished artwork from Stats pasted down. I even drew some original Tony Stark stuff. And then when we did the Submariner, 80% of that was brand new. And I'm learning from Mel Keepers and Doug Wildey and Mike Ahrens, who really became my mentor at the studio. He was Big Mike and I was Little Mike. And then wound up, before I'd even met Jack, laid out one-third of the Saturday morning Spider-Man shows. And so one night, my wife, my first wife and my kids, who were AAU competitive swimmers, are up at the junior college in the pool doing their daily workouts. I'm walking across the backyard, it's about 6 o'clock, the phone rings in the kitchen. I run in, I go, hello? Mike Ryer? That's a Jack Kirby. Alex Tell says you're a pretty good anchor. And I'm going, holy crap, what kind of a horrible trick is somebody pulling on me? And, you know, I said, Jack Kirby? He says, yeah, I'm living down here in Irvine, and you know, Alex Tell says you were a good anchor. Would you like to come down and pick up, or do something for me? And so I always carried a little box with ink, pens, pencils, erasers, you know, the old wire thing you'd stick your brush in, the bottom where you could put your water. And I always had that in the car, and so it just happened to be with me. I meet Jack and Roz, and it's like, this guy, this is Jack Kirby, but he's like Uncle Bill. And he showed me the piece, which was that first one of those early pieces he did for Marvel Mania, where he's sitting at the drawing board. And I say, oh, okay, can I bring it back to you tomorrow? And he says, well, why don't you just do it here? To me, that was like there couldn't be any worse pressure in the world. It was worse than if your wife caught you with your mistress. It's like, how do you handle this? You know. And so every 20 minutes, Jack comes in and is looking over my shoulder. We break for lunch, and Roz has made us sandwiches. And it's like, not only is this Jack Kirby, who was one of my top icons, it's like, this is extended family. And that very first visit, I mean, the Kirbys were just incredible human beings. I met both daughters, and after that, I started inking stuff for catalogs and things that Jack would pencil for Marvel Mania. And then, as I've said this a million times, he called me from the airport and said, I'm going somewhere, I've got you in mind, and that was it. But you talk about your career and coincidences and stuff. My career is so much luck. When the Marvel Superheroes closed down production, it coincided with Western Publishing wanting more work from Russ Manning. And Russ Manning told the editors that the only way he could do more work was with my help, but he couldn't pay me enough that I could make a living. So Chase Craig at Western Publishing, the editor, called me up and said, would you like to come in and pick up some work? I mean, it's not the old, can I come in and show you some samples? They figured if Russ trusted me, and so the first thing I did was penciled a Superboy frame trade trouble that George Wilson painted on the East Coast. And a few months later, I got a call from the animation studio saying we're going to be doing Spider-Man. So I went in and met their new business manager or production manager, and to show you how smart the studio was, he'd come from the construction trade. And I said, I can only give you 20 hours a week. And he said, well, 20 hours, I can't give you screen credit. Stupid 20-something naive kid in the screen carpet. All I had to do was tell them, and they would have jumped all over me, and my name would be on all 20 episodes. After 3 weeks of working directly with Grant Simmons, the Grant of Ray Lawrence. He said, "Mike, we got a problem." And I said, "What?" He said, "Everybody in the house is madder than hell at you." And I said, "Why?" He says, "Because you're doing more in your 20 hours than they do in 40 in the house." And I said, "Then what do I do?" He says, "Bill me for 40. But it was just, it was a case of, when Spider-Man was finished, then there was another call from somebody saying, this is happening, and then boom, there's the call from Jack, and it's like, sometimes I wonder, you know, in the whole overall picture of comic books, I'm just one cog in that huge wheel, all those mechanical wheels running together. But I was lucky to get to work with two of my all-time favorite icons, to work with an ape, Russ Manning, so none of you will know what I did for Russ. Even on the last several months of the Tarzan Sunday comic strip, where he, bless his heart, signed it, Manning and Royer, I penciled and inked it all, and I lettered and inked it all, and on the last Sunday, penciled it. Russ just gave me thumbnail sketches and said, it's the last one, do it. And I owned it for a while because he told Burroughs Incorporated that he had knocked his coffee over on it, but fortunately after he made a protection stat.
Let me interrupt here for one moment. We have to take a pause to
please do.
When the cameras change tapes, or cartridges, or memory cards.